Thank you. Well, good evening and welcome to the London home of the IET during this British Science Week. The IET exists to engineer a better world, inspiring, informing and influencing engineering and technology innovation to meet the needs of our society. We're delighted to be joined by some of its members here tonight, some of whom are academics at Royal Holloway. The IET vision of innovation working for society is one that we share at Royal Holloway, and this makes the IET here in Savoy Place the ideal venue to host our 2017 Stevenson Lecture, which tonight will explore what happens when people and technology comes together. Like the IET, Royal Holloway is a community which brings together academics to collaborate and inspire each other to tackle global issues. This work often involves multiple disciplines, and it's encouraged us to extend our expertise at Royal Holloway into new areas that are relevant to tonight's theme in particular. In 2015, we opened a new School of Law, enabling us to address the legal and ethical issues associated with technology and its use by people and organisations. This summer, we will be welcoming the first students into our new Department of Electrical Engineering, enabling us to address both the software and hardware dimensions of technology. Now, the Stevenson Lecture is Royal Holloway's annual science lecture, inaugurated in 1922 in memory of a former council member and benefactor of the college, Miss Margaret May Stevenson. Over the years, invited speakers and Royal Holloway academics have delivered these lectures on a diverse range of topics, most recently giving insights into the birth of cryptanalysis, new theories of evolutionary succession, the properties and potential applications of graphene, and the UK's role as a world leader in adapting big science capabilities to forward scientific research in the fields of particle physics and astronomy. It's through lectures on topics such as these that we are able to expose the powerful work our universities are pursuing and its applicability to the challenges we face. Now, tonight you will hear expert insight from Dr. Lorenzo Cavallaro and Dr. Stephen Walterson of Royal Holloway's Information Security Group, part of the School of Information Security and Mathematics, and famous, I think, for its world-leading interdisciplinary research dedicated to information cybersecurity. Through the Information Security Group's close links with government and industry, it addresses a range of challenges, from the protection of business-critical infrastructure to our personal security as we engage at an individual level with new technologies. Now, joining Lorenzo and Stephen is Dr. Marco Cinerelli from our Department of Psychology, an expert in the human factors that influence the way that we engage with digital innovation. Royal Holloway's psychology department is one of the top five in the UK, and its expertise ranges from cutting-edge research into human perception, memory and language, risk and decision-making. This joint lecture between Royal Holloway's Information Security Group and Department of Psychology will show us the intertwined challenges of evolving technology and its interaction with the human brain. It will bring to life how new cybersecurity threats can affect our everyday lives, and it will explore why we act the way we do when faced with these new threats. So thank you for coming this evening. I hope that you enjoy the presentation. I'm sure we will all learn something and be inspired to reflect on our own relationship with technology. Before I welcome our speakers onto the platform, there will be an opportunity to ask questions at the end of the lecture to our experts, and indeed to continue the conversation over drinks outside in the reception areas. So please welcome our three speakers onto the platform.
Thank you, Paul, for the nice introduction, and welcome everyone here this evening. So let me just get straight to the point. Would have you clicked on this? Just raise your hand. Don't be shy. You don't get any mark. Okay? So, probably, but I would say most likely not.
Why?
Well, there's not much contextual information in this URL, in this link that's just been brought to you. So maybe at this stage, you don't want really to click on the link, so because you don't have enough information to take an informed decision. Where does this link point to? Don't really know. It can point to a legitimate website, that's fine. It can point towards some threat. You don't really want to do that. How about actually you start getting additional contextual information? And let's just assume that this is about us, right? So we're busy in our life, everyday activities, with kids, work, commitments, and so forth and so on. So time is really relative, and Einstein already told us about this, right? And we sometimes need to take decision very quickly. So if you just phone, if your phone beeps, you just receive a notification, you see very quickly what it is, you see a link, it's a diary, it's an agenda reminder or something like that, and there's a link, so you know that you need to prepare the presentation, you need to finish reading some papers for a meeting that you are just working on, and it's very much likely that you might just click on a link like this, because there's additional information that would enable you to say that this is pretty safe, or should be safe. This is actually something that happened to us as we were preparing this lecture. So we're just going back and forth sharing presentations like deck, and it started getting a bit bigger to send it over email. So we decided to use a sharing provider to actually send a file among us, among ourselves. And Steven sent an email to all of us, and this is what I got, basically. So if you can look the subject of the email, it says Uninet File Sender Stevenson Slides. Okay, first cue, Stevenson Slides, so it rings a bell, right? I'm sure that to you guys as well. The from, so the sender of the message is Steven Watterson. Also, it rings a bell. Although the domain, so the sender domain, doesn't really match Royal Holloway, University of London. It's something else, ntnu.no. I have no idea about it. And if you look at the text, there's not much contextual information, really. Like, there's a very short body that says, good afternoon, as the file is getting quite large, I'm using a separate sharing service. Sorry. Best, Steven. Okay, now we're running late for the preparation of this presentation. So of course I clicked on the link, right? And luckily enough, this time was a legitimate link. So I downloaded the slide deck and we were able to continue preparing the presentation. However, once you click on a link, there are many things that can happen. So you can most likely end up on a legitimate website or opening a legitimate document. But at the same time, you can be the target of social engineering scams, or even worse, this can be the starting point for a whole chain of event that would end up having your computing platform, and I would like to underline platform here. It's not just your PC, it's your mobile phone, it's your laptop, it's your tablet. You can end up by being infected with malicious software. So software that's been designed to perform unauthorized actions, steal sensitive information, financial information, and perform all sort of nefarious tasks nowadays on the internet. Distributed denial of services, scanning a large scale, a different host, and so forth and so on. So one of the most predominant social engineer attacks that we are a victim nowadays, it's phishing scam. Basically, the attackers try to exploit human beings. The idea is that you receive a link that eventually will lead you to a web page that is legitimate resembling. So it really resembles a web page of a service that you know about. But indeed, it's not something that is legitimate at all. It's something that's been set up by attackers to steal sensitive information or financial information. If we look at this page here, well, at first glance, it could look like a Facebook login page, right? So if you just base your decision on what you see in the page, you're just more likely able to provide information here, to fill all this form and to insert your passwords and so forth and so on. But if you look more carefully at the URL over there, the highlighted one, so you can see that the domain is not really Facebook, it's something else. It's www.sanagustinesturismo.co/Facebook. So this is a phishing attack because the web page doesn't really belong to Facebook. It's been set up by attackers to steal your information, okay? Now, we're able sometimes to detect these attacks because we have some visual cue that allow us to understand whether something looks dodgy or not. As we move away from this visual cue and we use platforms that are more user-friendly, mobile phones, tablets, all these visual cues start disappearing. And therefore, we have less information that we can use to actually understand whether we're dealing with a legitimate web page or not. Okay? The other problem is exploiting human beings on one side. The other side is exploiting software that eventually will lead to a chain of event that would unload malicious software. One of the most notorious malicious type of malicious software nowadays is ransomware. Ransomware is just a specific malicious software that once it infects your computing device, it either locks the device or encrypts all the sensitive information. And then it asks for a ransom. Literally, it asks for money. So if you provide the money, you might have your data back or not. There's no guarantee. You're dealing with criminals, right? There is a reputation here, of course, you know, because if the reputation is that they don't actually return the stolen information, then you end up not paying at all. But this is quite serious. And if we look at some raw statistics, this is just some numbers that come from McAfee, but every vendor has sort of the similar numbers. So they might vary just slightly, but the trend is always the same. So when it comes to new phishing URLs, so new phishing domains, in 2016, the end of the quarter, McAfee collected and observed more than 5 million different unique new phishing URLs, which means that they need to deal with 13,000 and more daily checks to understand whether what you're dealing with is malicious, dodgy, or not. If we move to malicious software instead, this is more staggering because we're talking about more than 600 million unique samples that you need to deal not every day, but you know, in total. And this basically leads to 800,000 of unique samples that you need to check every day for infection. You need to check, of course, the antivirus company. When we talk about ransomware, this very specific class of malicious software, it's definitely on the rise. Why? It's a very old problem, but nowadays it's very easy to ask for a ransom because you have a very sophisticated infrastructure. You can use Bitcoin to guarantee sort of, you know, pseudo anonymity for the payment. You can hide servers that exchange cryptographic information with the malware behind anonymous networks such as Tor and so forth and so on. So ransomware is on the rise with more than 8 million samples at the end of 2016. Mobile malware is also on the rise as well. McAfee counted more than 13 million unique samples in their databases at the end of 2016, which means that they need to check on average 25,000 samples a day. Why do we fall for this? What is the problem? Why do we click on a link? Well, I believe that on one side is because we are curious, right? So you receive something and you're just curious to click on it. When you see something on Facebook, I'm sure that you guys are really there that you want to click on the link because you want to see what's behind this very nice advertisement that your friends are sharing. Perhaps this is just our behavior, but as I mentioned, it might not just be that because I mentioned some visual cues, so there must be something that is a bit more sophisticated that goes on into our brain when we take this decision. So I believe that it might be just time to ask someone that knows more about this topic to help us here. Marco, please, can you lend us a hand?
So humans and technology come together, and what happens, usually there's some kind of problem. We can see from the statistics here that perhaps up to 95% of information security issues have human factors at their heart in one way or another. And we could ask the question, well, what do we do to solve this problem? Well, one thing that some people would like to do is remove the human being completely from the equation. And of course, this might seem extreme, but we live in a world in which driverless cars are being designed, and this is a real possibility. What often happens is that we try to throw technological solutions at what sometimes is a human factors problem. So a problem happens, a leak is sprung in something like a bucket full of water, and we seek to plug that one specific leak. And we deploy technology and it works. It plugs that one leak in the bucket for a while, But if we've got a really rusty bucket, we know that at some point in the future, it's going to spring a leak somewhere else. And we're then having to deploy technology again. Firefighting all the time without really getting to grips with what is causing those leaks to spring in that bucket in the very first place. One of the things we can look at in terms of human psychology to begin to understand why these kinds of human factors issues happen is the fact that one of the things we do is tend to try and reserve our resources. Many of you will have mobile devices, laptops, mobile phones, that conserve processing power much of the time. Technologists talk about CPU throttling, so the processor, the brain at the heart of your mobile devices, will save power when it's not needed. And then when you throw at it a really tough task, like working on HD video or something like that, the fans spool up and the processor speed increases. Now, we do this as human beings as well, but we don't have a clock speed that we turn up to set our brains to 4 gigahertz. It's happening outside our conscious awareness. We're holding back on our brain's processing power and only deploying it when we fully need it. Now, we can address this psychological problem at a range of different levels. Starting at the top, for example, society. We can talk about culture and how that impacts information security. We can move down the pyramid and talk about what happens in organizations. Right to the bottom and think about the individual user. And we can bring in all of these disciplines that are listed here to try and help us understand these problems. And I'm going to try and touch base with all of those levels of the pyramid in the different segments that I'm going to speak to. But let's start by talking about this problem that sometimes we think in what Ellen Langer talks about as a mindless way. Most people are just not there, and they're not there to know that they're not there. I don't know whether we're there or not this evening, but Langer's point is that we often are on a kind of psychological autopilot. And why we're talking about that this evening is that the social engineer can leverage that to their benefit. Langer sought to prove this point by conducting an experiment in the 1970s in her university in the US. She took out all of the functioning photocopiers in the library and left one remaining photocopier. So you can imagine in the 1970s, the library was busy with lots of students wanting to copy journal papers and so on. A very long queue forms at the photocopier. And she has a confederate go to the front of the queue and ask to push in and use the copier straight away. But there are three versions of what that confederate says. In the first version, there isn't really any particular reason given. The request is given. Now, in the second version, there is a request, and following that request is what sounds like a legitimate reason. Well, I'm in a rush. What we're interested in is that third version, where a request is made, but the reason given is facile. It shouldn't really result in any kind of compliance. Now, if we look at the figures here, we can see that they're a relatively kind bunch at this American university. 60% let somebody push in with no reason at all. 94% let somebody push in who had a legitimate reason to provide. But what proportion do you think of people approached would accept a facile reason like that last one? Anybody want to throw out a number at me? 90%. Anyone? Okay, so we can think about what that percent might be, but what Langer found was that that percentage drops just 1%. So according to Langer, this is an example of mindless human behavior. What we talk about as heuristics, these are mental shortcuts that help us get through life because we can avoid our internal CPU throttling up, our brain having to exert itself. In this case, the idea being that we tend to have an assumption that if somebody comes to us with a request followed by a reason, it's going to be legitimate. And so we don't actually deploy our brain's resources to listen to the reason that follows. Now, that's interesting. Does it apply in any other context? Well, look, imagine your weekly supermarket grocery shop. We see signs like this. And Lorenzo, if you saw a sign like this, what would you think?
Well, I would definitely have to buy 2 bottles to get the deal.
So we see a sign like this, we look and we think, well, to get this offer, we're going to have to buy two bottles. Stephen probably thinks, well, hang on a minute, I'm going to check the price of Robinson's in the 10 nearest supermarkets on an app or something like that. But we look at the rest of the sign and we see, actually, you don't have to buy two to get the special offer. But of course, the marketing team in the supermarket know that through mindless processing, we probably won't pay attention to that part of the sign. We're engaging in a kind of human autopilot, but instead of the pilot, like they would do on an Airbus, reaching over, pressing the autopilot button on this Airbus autopilot panel, we're not aware that we're doing that. And the fact that we're not aware that we're doing it makes us vulnerable to social engineering. It's at times when we don't know that we're vulnerable that we're most vulnerable. And so these heuristics, these mental shortcuts, are applied when we use and when we think about technology and when we think about threats to that technology. We develop mental shortcuts to help us detect threats in our environment. So, for example, most of us in the room will have an idea of what a phishing email is. It's an email that is designed to fish for us, making a mistake, clicking through, and then somebody's going to grab our details and take them away and do something nasty with them. Now, when we think about something like a phishing email, we have, if you like, a schema, what a psychologist calls a schema, which is kind of a stereotype. We have a view of what a typical phishing email will look like. And for many of us, we think that when we see reassuring signs that we're familiar with, such as these kinds of logos, it's probably less likely to be a phishing email. So we have a set of criteria that is defined for us by what we call a schema or a heuristic. And it tells us, watch out for these things, because most of the threats are going to look like this. For example, people tend to think spelling and grammatical errors come with phishing emails. And so we're looking for that. Our perception is tuned to be looking for these particular things. And over time, these ways of thinking become habitual. We don't think about doing this, it just happens. This can have really scary consequences, thinking in a heuristic way, as I discovered when I sent my son down the aisle of the supermarket in search of some Parmesan cheese, when I wanted to create an authentic risotto recently. And to my horror, when I got home, I discovered that what my son had put in the supermarket trolley was instead this wonderful Czech cheese on the left here. And of course, the psychologist in me thought, okay, I can see why my son has done this, because this Czech cheese, kind of masquerading as Parmesan, is the same shape. It's got a picture of a nice, pleasant landscape on it, just as the real, authentic Parmesan has. It's even got this crown symbol, which some Parmesans have stamped on the rind of the Parmesan. So if I sent my son down the aisle, yes, he's looking for certain properties of that cheese, and he's ticking them off in his head. Yes, it's the right shape. Yes, it's got a picture of the countryside on it. Ooh, it's got a crown on it as well. I remember seeing that on Parmesan. So he's reached an authenticity threshold and pushed beyond it and said, yes, this is the real authentic thing. Just as we might look at something like a phishing email, if it ticks the right boxes, we can make exactly that kind of error that my son made. It wasn't the best risotto, and of course, not having the right cheese gave me a good reason for it not being the best risotto, rather than me just not being a great chef. And of course, I didn't tell my son that he had any role in that. But when we think about phishing emails, one of the heuristics that tends to be triggered quite a lot is one around urgency and a sense of loss. Because psychologists will tell you that one of the things we hate the most is losing the chance to control what happens to us. And so if messages are coming to us saying you've got a very narrow window to click on this, otherwise something bad is going to happen, what we tend to get is a kind of tunnel vision perception. We focus on that threatening piece of communication. You won't get this FedEx delivery unless you click here now. Your bank account is going to be frozen unless you click on this and do something about it now. This narrows down our perception, and the social engineer can use that to their advantage, because what we do is we still reserve that processing capacity. So it's all taken up by processing the scary bit of the message. And the other bits of the message that might actually give us a clue that this is not a genuine message from RBS or HSBC or FedEx, we tend not to process because of these heuristic biases. Now, these schemas that we have are about all the objects in our world. And one of the problems of the Internet of Things that we face today is that when we think about security problems, we tend to think about them as associated with these things on the left of the screen. I recently bought one of my sons, one of these indestructible kiddie cameras. And I was quite intrigued one day to wander along to his bedroom and see that he was making his own vlog on this camera. And he'd obviously seen, you know, YouTube vloggers, and he decided to emulate them. And he was making this cute little vlog about a day out that we'd had. And I thought, this was great, this was cute. Then I recognized and remembered that this actually was a Wi-Fi enabled camera. And that not only could he upload these little cute vlogs as a seven-year-old that he was making, but in theory, someone could hack this camera and the website it connects with and upload their own videos to his camera. And this made me realize that when we think about many things in our lives, whether it be teddy bears, whether it be dolls, whether it be baby monitors, we tend not to think of them as vectors for security threats. But in the interconnected world of things, they are. All of these things have already been hacked. And the idea that a hacker is sitting watching your baby through your baby monitor isn't a very pleasant one. But psychologically, one of the things we need to do is think about things like this. A refrigerator. Who thinks of a refrigerator as a security threat? I open my fridge and most of the times it's empty because my kids have been through like a plague of locusts. I don't think of my fridge as a potential, you know, way in for a thief to perhaps determine whether I'm at home or not. But of course, probably if I had an interconnected fridge, I should be thinking of it in that kind of way. So one of the challenges is to stop us thinking about security threats as affecting these things on the left and really broaden the schemas we have about these objects. And so one of the ways that we can use our understanding of psychology here is when we face things that we're familiar with, we can understand why somebody might not assume that something like an Outlook calendar invite is threatening, because we don't necessarily have a schema that Outlook calendar invites are threatening, that we can get threat vectors in this way. We look at links and we see something like Google, and these hit what we're looking for in terms of authenticity rather than suggest that a threat is coming along. But if we do click on these things because our schemas are making us think in a slightly strange way, what can happen, Lorenzo?
You're in a bit in serious trouble. I personally like very much the idea of having mental schema. So if someone would just complain because you're slow replying to email, now you have the excuse, I'm processing, right? So give me my time. So let's assume that now we have to deal with our everyday life. We got, as Marco mentioned, this Outlook calendar notification. And because we don't have the right schema or we're tricked into believing that this is a legitimate schema, then we click finally on a link. So what could happen? Well, we mentioned that you can end up by visiting a legitimate website or you are in trouble. What does it mean that you are in trouble? That if we forget the human aspect for a second, where people try really to trick human beings and perform social engineering attacks, let's just move on the software side, okay? So after all, you're using a computer, and this is what the attackers are after before they completely are able to infect your machine. So there are many ways that this works, and it works because of two main issues, okay? So there are many others, but there are two main big problems. One is known as the in-band signaling problem, and the other one is known as memory corruption attacks, okay? So I'm trying to simplify here something that is quite complex under the hood. But so we have to use our full brain capacity at this stage. But the in-band singularity problem is something that can be dated back ages ago, and even till the 70s, where I'm not sure whether you guys have recognized him. It's even in the slide, so I shouldn't have put it in the slide, but this gentleman is John Draper, also known as Captain Crunch, and known for starting the movement of phone phreaking, so as a way to hack the telephone system. And the problem is because back then, he found out that a whistle that was given in a Captain Crunch cereal box was emitting a frequency, 2600 hertz. And this frequency, once you just took the phone handle and tried to connect to AT&T, this very same frequency was the one that authorized long distance calls free of charge. So the problem here is known as in-band signaling, because the same channel was used to send, to accept data from users, voice, and also to control the system to do something, okay? So you had these two pieces of information together, user controllable information and control information mixed in the same channel. This is very bad. This is a bad design. We shouldn't really be doing this. The problem is that our modern computing platforms, they follow what is known as a phenomenon architecture, and this is what happens. So we have many things that are mixed into each other. So everything in memory contains user data, and as you have user data, you have also some control information that is needed by the program to work properly. Now, if the attackers have a chance to control that information, then is where they can take over the behavior of the program, okay? So in-band signaling is the first problem, and we still have nowadays. The other problem is known as memory corruption. As the name suggests, this allows to corrupt some region in memory of a program. So this, a computer is made of a CPU, many devices, many components, but a CPU that executes instructions and a memory that holds instructions and data, okay? Memory corruption simply means that you're corrupting some memory location. Now, the tricky point is that here, if you are able to corrupt memory location that that contains those control information that are needed for the program to work properly, then you can effectively control the program itself. So this is something that, so the most notorious event dates back to 1988, when Robert Morris Jr., at that time was a grad student at Cornell University, basically wrote the first exploit, the first attack to exploit one of this type of vulnerability, software vulnerability, memory corruption vulnerability. And as a consequence, he took down the internet of that time. So we had fewer computers, of course, not as many as we have nowadays, but because there was a problem in the software that he wrote to perform the attack, the software kept on replicating as he was infecting systems, and then it took down the whole internet at that time. Robert Morris Jr. now is a professor at MIT, so it turned out pretty good for him. And if you're lucky enough, you can meet him at conferences also. So this was in OSDI. I am the one on the right. it was in 2010 in Vancouver. Okay, so let me just try to explain a little bit better how memory corruption works, okay? I need to make simplification because the problem space requires some understanding on computer architectures and operating system in general. And to continue the analogy with food, I'm sorry, you got Italian heritage and Italian here. I cannot refrain myself to speak about food. So the analogy is, think about recipes, okay? So programs, before talking about programs and stuff like that, so what is a memory corruption vulnerability? It's the most common software vulnerability where attacker-controlled input is fed to a process, which is a program that runs in memory, to hijack its execution flow and execute arbitrary code so that the program behavior changes, the attacker is able to escalate its privileges, and malicious software can be installed at the end. What does it mean, all of this? Okay, let me just try to explain with an example and think about recipes. Okay, so programs are made of instructions. Instructions are grouped logically in functions, and those functions, they achieve some subtask, And all together, they just implement some algorithm. So an algorithm is just a set of rules. Think about a recipe, right? A recipe is just a set of rules. You have some ingredients, which is the input that you give to the program, the recipe. And then you have someone, the chef, which is, in our case, the CPU, that executes the program. So if everything goes fine, the recipe is a success because you're trusting the input that you are receiving. But if someone mangles and hacks the input, then the chef, which is just a mere executor, doesn't know what happens, and it keeps on executing whatever the input triggered. Okay? I can show you the details about the video later on if you want. Okay? So let's imagine that we want to make some sauce, like simple tomato sauce. Okay? And to do this, we have our program, which is here. Sorry, I'm a computer scientist, so I couldn't avoid having some C code here in the slide, okay? So everyone advocates for coding, coding, coding. This is my way to contribute to the coding motto. So this is a pseudo language, so similar to C, but it's very simple to follow. So the program starts here. So this is our recipe that receives some ingredients as input. And basically, we loop over all the ingredients and we chop every ingredient that we receive as an input. Then after this is done, we start browning the ingredients and we start cooking the ingredients, okay? I forgot you have to add a bit of sugar to kill the acidity of the tomato, but that's not important. Now, if you look at the implementation of the function, so you can think about this fictional language, low-level language, okay? That is very simple. So you copy things, you chop, you copy, and then you return from the function. So the function is over. Now, to achieve this concept of execution flow, the CPU, the chef, needs to know what to execute after the function terminates, right? So it needs to know that after you've chopped all the ingredients, you need to continue to brown and then to cook. So this is control information that needs to be stored somewhere. Where it is stored? On a computer, in memory. Everything is in memory, okay? Eventually gets in memory. So the program is in memory. The data that you receive, the input, is in memory. So we have onion, tomato. You can use garlic, of course. And then the program itself is in memory. So let's try to execute. So we are the chef, we are the CPU. Let's try to execute this. What happens? So the first things that happen, sorry, it's the wrong clicker, is that we copy the ingredient that was above there somewhere else, okay? And then as you found out, there is this additional information here, red 10, which is the control information that is added by the CPU, by the chef, that tells where the computation should continue once you're done chopping your ingredient. Otherwise, you don't know where to follow, okay? So you have to have this somewhere in memory. And this is an information that is pushed by the program. Then you continue, you chop the onion, and you copy it somewhere else, okay? And then once you return here because you want to move the onion somewhere else back. Now, this all works because the ingredients, everything is trusted. So you have someone that set up the ingredients for you, and the program is trusted, and everything looks fine. But as you can see here, we have user supplied data here, along with some control information. This is the in-band signaling problem. So they're right next to each other. Now, if I have a chance to influence this information here, well, I can make this function chop return not to this instruction, but to any instruction that I want, therefore changing the behavior of the program, okay? And this is what happens here. So let's assume that you have a malicious user that provides you tons of onions. It would have been better with garlic, but tons of onions, right? But also it provides some additional information here, which is not really a real ingredient, but it doesn't matter. On a computer, it's all zeros and one, okay? And this is considered to be input for the program. So all this information here is considered to be input for the program. So whenever chop executes again, whatever happens is that you have this control information that is put by the chef, by the CPU, because you want to know once you enter the function chop where to return your execution once the function terminates. And at this point, however, the problem is that this information is way too big to be copied over here, right? You have just four slots, but you have only three slots here. Now, if you're not careful when you do this copy, then what happens is that you overwrite the control information. See? You copy, and this red 10 gets overwritten with red 15, which is the one that the malicious user supplied to the program. At this point, once the program is done, instead of returning to the original point here, to the copy, it returns somewhere else, which is a point in the program where you can execute arbitrary commands. So this is pretty much how it works, a memory corruption vulnerability. The difference is that, unfortunately, we don't have onions, tomatoes, and garlic, but we have ones and zeros, okay? But this is what has been known for ages, since the 60s, since the language was sort of invented, and then all the way through nowadays. This is one of the most common way in which your computing platforms get infected nowadays because of exploitation of software vulnerability. It's a lot more complicated than that, but the idea underneath is this one. Of course, everything can be even further exacerbated by the fact that we don't have only a laptop or a computer, but we have a plethora of interconnected devices. Things cannot get any better. Huh, Stephen?
Yeah. Well, if you recall the calendar invitation that we had up a little bit, this was genuine. It's only been anonymized a little bit because it was a real calendar invitation that I've received. I just anonymized this. And what you don't see there is that actually, even in the genuine article coming from a Microsoft Exchange server, the Apple iOS user interface lies to you a little bit because it doesn't show you even the full clue that Marco was talking about. It truncates it a little bit to make it look nicer. So you don't even get the full information that you should be looking at, and you can't probably make a good decision. So this is one area where even companies that theoretically have quite a bit of resource to spend on how to design user interfaces correctly, how to get the correct user experience right, also in the security realm, are not really doing terribly well. And you can imagine if you have a small engineering company that builds Internet of Things components, they don't have the same budget, and they're likely to make even more dramatic mistakes. Well, that's one part of the problem that we have to deal with. The other is that not only are we not getting the clues for are we doing the right thing, we're also not really getting insight into what the consequences are of our actions. So instead of a little link, if we were to sort of say, please think when you lift the little flap from the red button before you actually do something, maybe we would engage our mental faculties a little bit better. But as you see, the devices that we use most often, these little mobile phones, they have limited real estate on the screen. We have limited time. So we're not being told what it is that we're doing. And we're usually under pressure, and we're not having that information about what the consequences are going to be. So let's maybe take a quick look at some possible consequences. Now, my colleagues have been talking about phishing. And of the advanced version of phishing is actually spear phishing. Now, if I had been a devious soul, which I'm sure I'm not, I would have used that email that I've sent to my colleagues more or less in the same style, basically providing additional clues that are tailored to that specific situation. So you've heard it before, so there were a couple of keywords. There were sort of previous meetings, reference, and so on. Now, a lot of this information, you're leaking out all the time. For example, people know you a little bit, they have access to your social media feeds and so on, so it can construct a story that triggers your threshold that is way beyond what you would be expecting in a normal generic phishing email that relies on generic clues. So this is also essentially the most commonly used trick that so-called advanced persistent threats, national intelligence agencies will use, because you don't need to actually worry about penetrating a complex piece of software. Human trustworthiness works most of the time. So if I trust Lorenzo, then giving me the right clues will make me trigger this. Now, technically speaking, the reason why fishing or spear fishing is so attractive is because the way of our information systems, our security systems being set up. Now, most of the time, if you're in a network, any activity coming from the outside in will be blocked because that might be malicious. But if there's an action that is triggered by somebody on the inside, that will normally be considered as legitimate. But the very act of clicking on that link makes it appear that this was a voluntary act. So therefore, it's fine to actually initiate that connection to the outside. And as I said, it's much cheaper for the attacker because you don't need to find an expensive vulnerability, which you would have to buy in the open market for a couple hundred thousand. What makes this interesting, what is of particular importance, is the consequences, because this is just the first step along the journey. Now, it might end with a ransom request, but it is also possible that you end up with a way of penetrating deeper into your system, into those of your colleagues on the same network, and from then onwards to cause even physical damage. Let's look at a couple of numbers. Phishing attempts, so the raw numbers keep going up, and it goes up because it works. So criminals have a very keen mind for numbers, so that they can see that the revenue is there for the taking. And one of the more amusing statistics here is that the so-called open rate that phishing criminals will get is quite competitive, I'm told by our people in the communications department, compared to direct marketing campaigns. So it seems that some of these phishing people have a better understanding even of the right clues that I have to give you compared to people working for a living in the communications of, well, large corporations that have substantial marketing budgets. Now, you might think that you're probably not vulnerable to this. Now, unfortunately, let me sort of put a little bit of cold water on this. So, 2 years ago, Intel ran a fairly large study where they had a reasonable cross-section of user population. And you've had about 20,000 people presented with emails, and you were being asked, is this phishing? Is it a genuine article or not? And it was a forced binary choice. Now, the bad news is that, you'll see with such a large sample size, it's pretty representative. On average, our subjects missed 1 in 4, and the number of people that got it right every single time was a vanishingly small 3%. Are you among the 3%? Now, that's bad enough already, right? And maybe Lorenzo now has an excuse to never open an email again. But we'll have another look later on at how it actually doesn't even take a click. There are more advanced techniques that enable me to penetrate a victim system if you just look at something. And as Lorenzo had already mentioned, the ingredients, so to speak, I'm not Italian, but I'm allowed to continue with the analogy, the ingredients have been there for a long time. It's just that between anonymous communication and anonymous payment systems, it is now a perfectly viable business model to extort ransom from individuals. And in fact, we've just, at the beginning of this year, had an incident where a large London trust, I'm not going to say which one, was essentially go back to the 1980s because they've had a malware infection in their entire clinical systems. So they had to go back to basically whiteboards, paper, and just marker pens to deal with the day-to-day hospital operations. Result in this case, several thousand non-urgent surgeries cancelled, appointments cancelled. So our hypothetical person walking through his daily life might not be directly the one that clicked on a silly link, but you can be affected in your real life because some real system, even a physical system, was affected by this. And you can easily see how this could happen. So people in the NHS tend to be quite busy. There's a shift change. I just got the results from an X-ray, and I just have to hand it over to a colleague of mine. Yes, the policy says I'm not supposed to put USB sticks somewhere, but the official system is on the blink, and I'm in a hurry. I have to leave. There's a shift change. Marco, here's the X-ray. Deal with it.
Thanks. So I shouldn't have been handed this USB stick. But of course, one of the things we know about human beings is throw rules, regulations, procedures at them, and they'll find a way around them. Sometimes creatively, sometimes deviously. But one of the things we're really good at is tweaking rules and procedures. Sometimes in industries where we really wouldn't expect this to be happening. That's a pretty annoying sound, isn't it? And it's supposed to be annoying. It's not the fire alarm, by the way. On a fateful day in 1987, as the crew of an MD-82 airliner lined up on the runway at Detroit, that's the sound they should have heard. And it would have told them that they hadn't correctly configured the airplane for takeoff. They hadn't set the flaps and slats correctly. They didn't hear that sound. They took off, and very quickly, the aircraft nosedived onto a highway. All of the crew were killed, all bar one of the passengers were killed. There was no technical fault with that aircraft. That oral warning system had had the power to it disabled, cut. At some point, possibly someone on that airliner had reached over to this panel here and pulled the circuit breaker. And of course, it's one of many examples of technology that is implemented to try and make us safer, but implemented by someone who doesn't necessarily think it through. Because when the air crash investigators talked to MD-82 pilots, one of the things that emerged is that this damn warning system had a tendency to trigger during the taxi phase, as you were taxiing out to the runway, and it was damn annoying. I don't know how many of you have reached over and turned off your alarm clock because it's so annoying, and then, you know, wake up an hour later and find that you're late for work or something like that. So people design these things to be annoying, but if they're so irritating that we disable them, then we're failing to understand the human response to this technology. And that human response may have been the cause, whether it was this crew or the crew before them on this aircraft, decided to disable that system, forgot to re-enable it. Had it been there, the crash would have been averted. It's one of many examples. You could look at the nuclear industry as well, where these sorts of issues arise, where we introduce technology, but we fail to really understand the human response to it. Take, for example, the wonderful passwords that we're all asked to generate now. Isn't it great that we're asked to generate these long passwords with all of these non-alphabetic characters in them? They're so great that we can't remember them. So what do? We have to find a way of remembering them. Now, if we're good, if we're, you know, doing what we're supposed to do, we might use a kind of password manager, which is sort of secure, but not necessarily. But it is putting all of your eggs in one basket. If we're being a bit silly, we'll put all of our passwords in something like a Word document and stick it on our desktop or something like that. If we're being really stupid, we'll put the password on a post-it note and stick it somewhere in our office. All of these things happen in response to technology when the technology is felt to get in the way of what we're trying to do. So you may have an organization in which you care very much about the way data is passed around that organization, especially when it's sensitive. You might not want people handing over USB sticks with patient data. What might you do? You might lock me out of using these USB sticks on the system. What might I do about that? Well, if I make a judgment that the costs aren't worth it, if I say, well, hang on a minute, what's the benefit to me of the NHS stopping me doing this? If I say the benefit's low, but the cost is high, well, I'm probably not going to do what you want me to. What I might do is say, okay, right, I'll grab a DVD burner and burn a few DVDs, stick them in a Jiffy bag and send them in the post. Of course, they could get lost in the post. I could leave them on a train. I could bring in an external disk drive. You tell me I can't use file sharing websites, okay? I'll pop along to Starbucks at lunchtime and I'll use a file sharing website there on Starbucks network where you can't stop me doing it. So if we deploy technological solutions which end up making people think that the cost isn't worth it, we're actually shooting ourselves in the foot. And it's something we need to think really carefully about, especially in an organizational context. Now, I'm embarrassed. We've got food again, as Italians, in our segments, and we're being very stereotypical, aren't we? But perhaps the biggest mystery of the entire evening is blancmange. Does anybody like blancmange? I mean, would anybody actually own up to liking blancmange? There's the biggest mystery. Well, this gentleman here, a few rows here, will admit to liking blancmange. Blancmange, a dish invented by the devil himself, is something I remember very well from my childhood. One of the things I remember about blancmange is that it tended to happen on certain days. And for school dinners, you could predict when blancmange was coming up. Psychologically, what was interesting is that ultimately I got to a point where I kind of said, well, yes, I know, it's blancmange day, right? Well, I can't do anything about it. I can protest to the head teacher that blancmange is the work of the devil and blancmange will still be served. What that did was it actually persuaded me that, you know what, maybe it's not that bad. And of course, one of the problems here is that if we persuade people that they're going to get fished all the time, that they're going to get hacked, that yes, the company will be brought to its knees at some point. Yes, we're going to lose data. Yes, we're going to have ransomware coming our way. You could end up thinking about those threats in the same way that I thought about blancmange. Yeah, okay, it's evil, but it's going to happen, and I can't do anything about it. Now, one of the ways we can think about risk and fear, and organizations can devise communications, is to use a model that was developed to understand health behavior, and it's called protection motivation theory. And psychologists like to use these long sort of terms, don't they? But these are the only long terms I'm really going to use. And it's not a very complicated theory. It basically suggests that when we think about threats, or we think about something scary that might happen, there's two strands to our thinking. On the one side is the threat evaluation. How can it impact me? What will happen to me if this happens? If it's within an organization, the employee is thinking, is this going to hit the organization? Is it going to impact me? Of course, they could think, okay, well, this might bring down the NHS. Do I care? Is it going to impact me personally? So there is an estimation of the threat. Is it likely? Is it going to happen? How vulnerable am I? And then there's also thinking around coping. Well, what can I do about it? What, as an organization, are you asking me to do about it? Do I understand what you're asking me to do? Are you really asking me to read these 500 pages of rules and regulations that I'm supposed to look through and understand what you're asking me to do here? Is it really going to protect me? And of course, one of the things the NHS has learned, that you can stick as many scary posters like this about smoking in a GP surgery as you want. But actually, if people sit there and think, well, you know what? Cancer's in the news every day. I'm going to get cancer anyway. So you know, why should I stop smoking? You know, the barbecue's going to give me cancer. So, you know, stop smoking, what's the point? We don't want people in organizations to think that, but if we just plaster posters like this in an office environment and expect people to be safe, well, why aren't they stopping smoking when we show them posters like this? Because they're thinking about the threat, they're thinking about the coping, and they're probably thinking, can't do much about it. It's going to happen. Now, of course, culture is something that we've become painfully familiar with, having been very stereotypical Italians and talked about food. And Stephen's going to talk about cars, and I'm not going to make a stereotypical comment about Germans and cars. Wouldn't want to do that. If we think about culture, it operates at different levels. There's a culture in an office. There's a culture in the IET. But there's national culture as well. One of the biggest challenges in the information security space is understanding how national culture impacts information security behavior. Look at these observations here on screen about different cultures. The first one, we have a culture in which rules are seen as a bit of a challenge. Give me a rule, and I'll come up with a way of bypassing it. Anybody want to throw out what country you think that might refer to? Speak up. Italy. Well, it could do. It could do, couldn't it?
Come on, that's a stereotype.
It's a stereotype.
It's a stereotype.
How dare we stereotype? So, but the second one's equally problematic. Imagine you're an auditor and you're working within a national culture in which yes seems to be the predominant answer, but actually behind the yes can be quite a complex answer that isn't coming out due to politeness. Any idea what that culture might be? America, Japan, a few different ideas. And the third one, a culture in which young people in particular don't like a management style where everything's handed down. Well, hang on a minute, let's think about the way organisations handle information security. Is it done at the local level or is it handed down from fairly high up offices located in one particular country? There's an interesting question, because if you're doing that in a culture like this, it's not going to be welcomed, according to this observation. Here are the actual countries that those quotations refer to. And of course, let me give an example of where this might be relevant. So our protagonist, who's had a bad day, they've perhaps clicked on a phishing email that came disguised as an Outlook calendar invite, works in a section where she's tasked with making sense of data provided by third parties who come into an organization, they parachute in, and they do penetration testing in the organization, ethical hacking, phishing simulations, test our organization, see how safe we are. And these third parties generate beautiful looking charts and graphs and infographics, and will say, yes, that site there, there's a problem there. That part of the business is performing in a risky way. That part, yeah, they're much safer. Then they parachute out and leave you to deal with understanding why those differences occur. And as a psychologist, my answer would be, well, culture's got to play part of the reason here. One of the reasons we see higher click-throughs in some cultures than others must be for these sorts of cultural reasons. And culture, of course, is related to place as well. And one of the things we've got to grapple with is how the psychology of ecology and environments is changing. When we think about organizations trying to imbue values, a way of thinking about risk within the workforce, it's one thing to try and do that within the office environment, but of course, a lot of us work at home. A lot of us enjoy popping out to Starbucks at lunchtime and working there on the Wi-Fi there. And so the psychological consequences of this is that these different ecologies, the workplace, the home environment, the home study, the internet cafe, are being melded together. The boundaries are blurring. We're asking you to sit at home in your home office and abide by the same rules, regulations, procedures, and values that we expect you to abide by in the office environment. How can we be sure that's going to happen? These are challenges that we don't really understand, just like the culture of how we use these devices is changing. We would initially see work-related devices as desktops and laptops primarily, but now we're using our phones to do our work. We're using portable devices like tablets. And so the way we think about devices needs to change as well in order to really appreciate this melding of workplace, leisure and personal spaces. Is our reliance on mobiles a problem, Stephen?
Yeah. Now, the problem with mobile devices is, of course, that it isn't just the psychologists that have their work cut out, it's the technologists as well. And part of the reason for this is financial. Quite simply, because when you think about how you're using a mobile device, it is almost impossible to get any meaningful use out of these devices unless you have a number of different accounts linked to the device. And companies like Apple, like Google, have every incentive to very tightly couple every single one of your activities, purely because that is how they gain intelligence in your everyday operations that most of the time will only be used to sell you more stuff that you don't need. Can you disable these accounts? Probably yes, but then the telephone isn't going to be very useful. Now, for instance, if you are using an Android mobile device without the calendar service plugged in, you don't get a huge number of features. So therefore, you can't leave it active. But that means that your calendar information is exposed over network, typically, of course, also then shared by other applications, some of which you have allowed deliberately, and in some cases you might have, but you don't even remember. And if you don't remember, then that might be just because you've clicked very quickly, or it might be because somewhere you've authorized a service and that service neglected to tell you that it was a transitive authorization, which allowed another service to reuse the authorization to use some of the same data. And it's very difficult to actually pull back these authorizations once you've given them. You're sharing all of this information, and sharing is, of course, a bit of a euphemism here, across any number of services, interested parties, including our colleagues from the fishing industry, or worse. Now, maybe after today's talk, you will decide you will become a better person, you will delete all of those accounts, and then afterwards create new ones. You will very carefully choose new passwords and will then not click on those buttons again very quickly. Will that make you a safer user? No, of course not. Because unless you bin the device, just one example of what might happen is that, well, the backups from those devices are also held in the cloud, which is good because before that, people just didn't do backups. Now, if I somehow have access to that backup in the cloud, I can try to break into the credentials that are stored on that device. Now, you might say, but of course these are encrypted. They are. How are they protected? With a password. Now, the human brain hasn't been upgraded lately, which means that the passwords that you can actually remember have a sort of maximum length. And as of the last data that we looked at was about last year, as of a couple of months ago, the computing power that I have to rent from Amazon Web Services, if they're not on the blink, would be approximately worth $20 to break the typical password. If I can get access to your encrypted backup, if whatever is stored on there, all the credentials, all your financial details, etc., is more worth more than $20, I'm in the black. And the difference to a couple of years ago is that it's no longer shady mafias or whatever government agencies that have those resources. No, I just rent them from a cloud-based service. I don't have any fixed infrastructure cost. It's a perfect business model. Now, those of a certain age might recall some of the devices that you see here in this illustration. And our mobile devices, to answer Marco's question, well, they've pretty much supplanted the vast majority of what you've seen here, and then some. Now, what is more interesting to us is not whether you can play music on those devices or not, but because all of the information that you're collecting in there, you're using these for your online banking. You're using them for all sorts of other financial services. we are using them in a so-called bring your own device environment for corporate documents, for our employers' work. Quite often these are exactly the same devices. But where it gets a bit worrying is that we're now moving into a realm where, for instance, you might have your medical records either stored or access to those records controlled by that mobile device. There's a legitimate argument for that because you don't want to be carrying around folders with your x-rays or have another x-ray taken, but obviously that's a bit sensitive. And where it gets a bit worrying for paranoids like me is that there's now a push to use the little near-field communication inside the mobile phone to act as a car key by just waving the phone near the car's door. But just raise the stakes a tiny bit. And it gets worse, because what we're drifting into is to use those mobile phones as universal authenticators. Anybody in control of those devices is in control of our lives. So what I was just talking about is of these primary services, the ones that you just add and add to the list of services that you have available. But where it gets really worrying is whenever you forget a password, how do you reset the password? How do you recover it? Now, you might get it sent to an email address, but if you even can't get into that, the ultimate recovery mechanism that most companies will use these days is they'll send you a text message. That's the last recovery option that you have. So if I've just managed, by way of this little calendar invitation, to get into your phone, I will have not only access to everything that's on the device, but to every transitively linked account. And you can't lock me out because I'm in charge of the thing that actually you want to reset. So that is a design flaw that the technologists really have to put on their to-do list. Now, I promised you a couple of minutes ago that it doesn't even really take a deliberate click on something that is malicious. Now, what could be the most harmless thing that you can think of? Kittens. Right? So what could possibly go wrong if you just look at a couple of cat videos to get your blood pressure down? Well, let me tell you what. The very act of viewing those videos might already allow me to inject malicious code into your device, and then from that onwards, follow the chain that I just tried to outline. Now, the clues that we were talking about earlier don't even work in this case, because unfortunately, it is possible, and this actually happens every day, that the content that is malicious, that has this exploit that Lorenzo was talking about earlier, is actually served to you by a server that comes from a legitimate site like Google, YouTube, etc. And they actually get paid for that, so-called malvertising. So if I would like to target a particular individual, I know his preferences, I will send an ad, I bid for an ad that has your characteristics precisely laid out, and in the milliseconds between you requesting the page and it being displayed, there will be video served that, under most circumstances, will just show you, I don't know, a car because you've been browsing for a new car, but maybe I'm a criminal that has malicious code uploaded onto the Google AdSense network. You get displayed this. And are you, for example, on Facebook? Are you using autoplay on your device when you first stream the video? No. Most of us are, because that's the default setting. You'd have to actually turn it off. So the moment that you look at the page, the video starts playing, and that's when the bad stuff has already happened. So can't Google, can't YouTube do something about this? Well, maybe, but it's really difficult. So just to give an idea of the magnitude of the problem, they're getting about 300 hours worth of new material every single minute. And they can do some rough checks for maybe copyright violations and so on, but if I'm able to lovingly handcraft a new vulnerability that simply hasn't been seen before, how would you possibly look for this? So I can inject that into the YouTube big pool of videos, and for all intents and purposes, it looks like a video that came from YouTube, and the moment that you load it or you look at it on Facebook, I am injecting a little bit of code. Don't worry, I'm not going to talk you through this. This is actually machine code, so this is probably a bit further than we wanted to go today. Now, this particular piece of code here has a little bit of history, in that this is a sample of malicious code that was found on machines on Syrian human rights activists. Syrian government, at some point, had carefully prepared websites such that whenever a user was logging in, for example, to sort of raise a complaint, this would get downloaded onto their machines, and then who knows what the very real physical consequences of that might have been. So, just the very act of looking at a video can lead to this entire chain of events where we really are having consequences right down in the physical domain. And as I said, you can't really pull this back because of the way that the technology has actually been set up. Now, we're playing to stereotypes to some extent, but I could have been talking about industrial control systems, about things like power networks and so on, but that wouldn't be quite sort of an everyday experience. Now, except for those of you who live in central London, most of you will probably have some day-to-day interaction with your car, and the problem there is that, again, technology is moving along rather rapidly. Now, car manufacturers are really worried that they're losing younger generations in that owning a car is no longer seen as such a necessity. So even mass market manufacturers, for example, like Ford in the US, have now decided that even their most low-cost models will now come with a permanent internet connection. And not only that, well, quite frankly, how powerful your engine doesn't really matter, since, for instance, the average speed here in London is still more or less the same as if we were using carts, so that doesn't really make any difference. So how do you differentiate? Well, by infotainment. And the consequence of this is that the amount of code that's being stuffed onto those four wheels is now truly stupendous. Now, if you take a current state-of-the-art jet aircraft, the Boeing 787 Dreamliner, when it's not grounded because of flaming batteries, this has about 6.5 million lines of code, which is 6.5 million opportunities to make a stupid mistake, or possibly more. Now, by comparison, if you look at the number of source lines of code in a modern, sort of reasonably high-end car, we're more than order of magnitude higher than that, more than 100 million lines of code. Much of this is concentrated in the infotainment system, and a lot of that, I'm not getting paid for, and they haven't paid me not to put it up. This is from a Mercedes car, but the systems are pretty much the same. What you're actually seeing here is something called Apple CarPlay, which links your mobile phone to the displays in the car, which links to the rest of the system here, so that you could, for example, actually use YouTube here playing back in the car to look at a video or to do something else. That means we're now integrating our external network interfaces, with these extremely complex systems where you just know that there will be mistakes made, because these operate on internet time, where product cycles are measured in months rather than in the 5 to 7 years more commonly used in the vehicular industry. So, question you've all been asking yourself, what could possibly go wrong here? Well, what could go wrong is that those systems are not terribly well separated from one another. And sometimes you actually want them not to be separated. So, for example, if you have a built-in satellite navigation system in the vehicle, a perfectly legitimate reason to interconnect these is if fuel is running low, you want to have a signal coming from your petrol tank to say, ooh, there's not much left, so that the navigation system will bring up the petrol station nearest to you and will guide you there so that you don't get stranded on the side of the motorway. Why does this work? Well, because the sensor here in the petrol tank has a way of communicating all the way to the screen being shared by your satellite navigation system, but also the entertainment system. And if there is a way to talk in one direction, you can be pretty sure that there's a way to talk in the other direction. Now, when we were preparing this talk a couple of weeks ago, I was just arguing with myself whether I should use this rather drastic example of vehicular systems or some other control system where something might fail. But it turns out that, thankfully, those of you who've been following sort of a little bit of the releases that have come out of WikiLeaks, the point has been made by others before, that basically that pathway from the permanent internet connection to the vehicular systems allows me, in this case, for example, to control the throttle body. If you press the accelerator, you just think you're pressing the accelerator. You're sending a signal to the engine control unit, so I can replicate that signal, even if you're not pressing. Similarly, you just think you're turning the steering wheel, and you operate some nice hydraulics and whatever. You're just sending a message that you would like the wheels to turn, and the software will deal with the rest. And so on, right down to the brake subsystem. As our friends out of Langley, Virginia said, this is actually a pretty clean and very difficult to trace way of getting rid of somebody. And all it takes is one careless click, because you're stuck in traffic, you just want to check your Facebook account. There's this video and we just wanted to invite you to use public transport on the way back. Now, let's have a look at what we've learned from today and where we might head next.
All right, thank goodness I don't have a car, so I'm halfway safe. But I do use all the other technology, of course. So, well, I believe that the takeaway message here is that the problem space is complex. And we definitely need to look at the problem as a whole. So far, when we talk about security, computer security, information security, we tend to think about something related to computer engineering, computer science only. But it's not just the point. As I believe we showed you guys this evening, the problem space requires an interdisciplinary reasoning, and within the same discipline, multidisciplinary as well. So this means that we need to engage in research that involves different actors from different disciplines. This is not easy because we speak different languages. Even within our same community, we just use different terminology when we do refer to a specific object. So it requires a lot of effort, and well, maybe this evening is just a first step forward, but we've been doing this already for a while. However, we don't have to neglect either silos, because as we mentioned, you know, you might click on the link. So the human being might have been exploited. Now, what we try to have as a first line or last line of defense, it depends on the perspective, is something that technologies, computer science, computer engineering can help us deal with. So I'm leading the System Security Research Lab within the School of Mathematics and Information Security at Royal Holloway University of London. And the lab, the research lab, focuses on system security. It builds on program analysis and machine learning to devise novel solutions to address system security issues, including those perpetrated by malicious software. I know this is not the right venue to say that, but we have openings. PhD and postdocs position, please do apply. But of course, you know, as I mentioned, we have to look at other silos on their own and also in a way to integrate them. So I'm sure that Marco has something to say here.
Well, like Lorenzo, I've got a lab as well, the Social Identity and Representations Lab in the Psychology Department at Royal Holloway. And what's interesting is that actually preparing for this lecture today was the first time I talked to these guys. So...
It's a big university.
It's a big place, right? But you know, they're doing stuff that we absolutely need. The technological side of things has to be tackled. I think I'm doing stuff that is quite relevant too. But isn't it interesting that until we had to do this, we hadn't talked to each other? And of course, that is a microcosm of what's happening more broadly in the academic world, but also if we look at organizations as well. We've got people tasked with looking after information security who are largely technically minded. There may be people-oriented persons within the organization, but they won't necessarily have the technological know-how. Bringing the two together is a real challenge. Working with multinationals in our lab, we're trying to bridge this gap between the technological solutions and how human beings respond to them. We're trying to answer questions such as, should we use a carrot or a stick approach when we're trying to encourage people to be safe? Do we want to frighten them? Do we want to threaten a big stick and say, if you don't do this, or if you do this, if you hand me that USB stick, you're going to get fired. Well, one of the answers there is that there is no one-size-fits-all solution. Those cultural differences that we just scraped the surface of course, impact the answer to questions like this. Should we use a carrot or a stick? What leads some human beings to usurp rules and procedures that we put in place? Why would some people actively try and get around those procedures? Understanding that cost versus benefit analysis that people are going through is really, really important.
Yes, understanding what some of the consequences are when the dominoes fall, and if there maybe is something that we could do to stop them falling over all at once. So these interdependency models and seeing how attack pathways might propagate are things that we're also looking at in the School of Mathematics and Information Security. One of the areas that we've barely scraped on, so we've seen examples ranging from fridges to cars, are things that interact with the physical environment. Now, whether that's industrial control system or the Internet of Everything, we're changing the way that we interact with our environment, and we have to come to grips with some of the implications also from a technological side. For example, we're now moving away from a screen-based interface to an audio-based interface. There are a number of consequences to this, and not always is it so benign as thousands of households ordering a dollhouse, because there was a segment on US television where a little child was saying that, oh, I'm so glad that Alexa, this device from Amazon, bought me a dollhouse, and the keyword Alexa, buy a dollhouse, was played back on network television, which resulted in thousands of dollhouses being shipped across the country. So clearly, even before we start talking about security, there's a couple of things that we have to get right.
Ladies and gentlemen, we've got just a couple of minutes for some, I think, short questions with some short answers, because we're keeping you from a drink outside. But let's, we've got a couple of roving mics. Anybody want to ask a question? Gentleman at the front here. And anybody else? Just wave your hand.
Hi, Dave Marcel. You showed a picture of Morris Jr. So it's well known that ISC, who provide the current version of Bind and Sendmail, are targeted by the TOA, an NSA group that's no longer in existence. But the real question is, in your opinion as a group, which Morris did the most damage? Was it Morris Jr. with, you missed out the fact that it's the worm he's noted for, or was it Morris Sr. who caused the Enigma algorithm to be embedded in Unix, which we are still suffering vulnerabilities from today?
Shall we get to the drinks?
Have a quick go at it.
Yes. That's an interesting question. So we actually been discussing about this. So Stephen apparently knows Robert Morris Sr. So let me just reflect this to Stephen.
I think between the two of us, we have a reason not to incriminate anyone. So I think we'll probably plead the fifth on this one.
Okay. Another question. Gentleman at the back there.
Hi. There seems to be two distinct streams of security here. You've got the administrative side for the people, process, policy-based security. You've got the technical side, which is your firewalls, your ACLs, all of the actual computerized stuff. How long do you envisage the first cyborg to come? Because I think that the thing that's very clear here is that there's no real communication yet between the people and the technology. Neither can stand by itself. There needs to be a level of integration to that. How do you see that moving forward the next 5 to 10 years?
You start.
Oh, well, you're asking the perennial pessimist in this case. I think if I'm making a start from a technical viewpoint, I think the pressure is there to load more and more automation onto systems. If we just use one example, Tesla has been working on their autopilot systems, and of course there's all sorts of disclaimers that you should not use this, but of course what people do is they're reading the newspaper, they're having a coffee, and they're just not paying attention to the road, because most of the time the benefit is in not paying attention. Now, what I see, and I think I've touched on this already in the epilogue, is that because of all this embedded systems taking over, you just wouldn't have the mental capacity to actually go out and configure all these things. So quite likely you're going to either rely on having this configured for you in some default, or you rely on an arm's length relationship where you don't really know what it is that you're doing. But I would challenge anyone that has, for example, home automation, whether they would ever bother to update the firmware on the thermostat in the spare bedroom.
Okay, perhaps one fun question. Gentleman in the middle here.
I have a question around that.
Hold on 1 second, there's a microphone just coming. We can all hear you, thank you.
Hello, my name is Abhilash. I'm a student of ISG. I'm doing my distance education. Quick question, the word trust. How can we make an ecosystem with a trust?
Trust.
Well, I think trust is something that we could talk all night about, isn't it? And I think one of the things that I didn't have very much time to talk about is what you might call the psychological contract. And especially in an organizational context, of course, when we want to understand why an individual or even a team might ultimately come to want to usurp and get around rules and procedures and act in a risky way, it's partly because of this psychological contract. We're talking about things like, is there a sense of identification with the organization? Is there a sense of commitment? Is there a sense of satisfaction with the job? And I think one of the reasons we see blips on graphs about why some sites, why some teams, why some individuals are more risky than others, is partly because of differences in this psychological contract. And one of the things organisations are going to need to get a handle on is how that contract differs between different categories of employee. If you've got fast turnover, how are you going to get that psychological contract in place? How are you going to build that trust? If it's not there, you've got to leverage safe behaviour through some other mechanism.
Thank you. Well, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We can carry on the conversation outside, but I think a fascinating insight into a problem that is truly challenging doesn't have simple answers. There are some simple guidelines in the back of the programme about be careful before you click and think about it. It feels like we've been sort of subject to a crime watch episode tonight, where we've all been terrified. But of course, at the end of that, they say, go home, relax, you know, don't worry about it, sleep well in your beds. It's good to know that we've got some stunning researchers working on these issues. We have things like the National Cybersecurity Centre that's just been recently opened, tackling these sort of issues at a national level. There are solutions being worked on, but we all have our role to play, I think, in thinking before we click. So if you can't sleep tonight after all that, do join us for a drink outside and help. Maybe that'll help you on your way. So please join with me in thanking Lorenzo, Stephen and Marco for a really fascinating insight into the challenges of the cyber world, and carry on the conversation outside with them over drinks. Thank you very much.